David, I said we can't just have you on down days on the market because you're one of the few who is predicting a recession in 2019. Has anything about the new year, the U-turn in the Fed, the better markets, the better data changed your mind?
Well, firstly, I want to thank you, Sarah, for proving that I'm not my own best contrarian indicator. But look, we have to take a look at the stock market this year in the context of what happened in December, because if we don't have a 22% plunge in the median stock and the S&P 500, we're not talking about, you know, this quotes, you know, slow melt up right now. You know, it's just interesting to me, you know, December is the worst December since 1931. And actually, in the opening months of 1932, if you look at the history, the stock market bounced back 20% before rolling over 50%. So the risk is that we're just living in the moment right now. You know, the best January since 1987 is curious to me because that's when I started in the business. But I know when I canvassed people about 1987, they don't remember January, they remember October. So I think that we have to take a look at what's happening right now, really in the context of the huge dive in the marketplace, the dramatic oversold conditions where some of the money center banks were trading at or below book value into that context. You know, there's no reason for me to change my macro view because of market gyrations that last 4 to 8 weeks. My view is really based on the myriad of leading indicators that I'm paying attention to. By the way, one of them is the guidance coming out of corporate America. You know, I noticed that, you know, we're seeing, banners talking about how over 70% of S&P companies are beating their estimates. That's really quite immaterial. What matters for people with a forward-looking vision is that the number of S&P companies issuing guidance that's negative is outpacing companies issuing positive guidance by more than a 3-to-1 ratio. 80% of the companies are actually issuing negative guidance. But what's really guiding my views for the coming year are the leading indicators. Capital spending orders, the core numbers are down 3 the past 4 months. They're clearly trending lower. That's a problem spot. We know from the pending home sales, which have continued to roll over, that housing is going to remain in its downturn for this year. We know exports are going to remain challenged by the negative data that we continue to see overseas. And the question is going to be, will consumers still be the glue that holds it together? And what concerns me, and I realize that the employment numbers on Friday seem to be stellar, but they're really coincident to lagging. I don't think you want to take a number for last month and superimpose it into the future. Nobody talks about the fact that auto sales were down 5% last month, and all of the consumer buying intention surveys right now are pointing south. So I just say this much, there's no such thing as a sure thing. My call is still for recession. It's not baked in the cake, but I do think it's going to be a very weak year for the economy. That's not fully priced in.
David, there's definitely a lot of risks out there, which are always important to make sure people take note of. I think the international slowdown in particular is of note and has spiked up more in the last couple of months. That said, I guess you have articulated a bearish point of view for quite a number of years, certainly all the time since I've been at CNBC in the US. So what factors would you say surprised you in the last 2 or 3 years that meant your bearish call hasn't come right yet?
Well, you know, I'll just say that, you know, in 2002 to 2007, when I was at Mother Merrill, I didn't catch any of that rally at all, but I think I did a better job this time around. I caught at least half of it, and I intend to do a better job in the next bull market. But actually, Wilfen, from 2012 to 2017, I was more bullish than I was bearish, and I started stepping up the rhetoric probably 12 to 18 months ago. But these things take time to build. The point I've been making all along from a big picture, before I was just talking specifically about the leading indicators, I'll just pose the question back. How many Fed tightening cycles did not land the economy in a recession? And the answer is that there were only 3 out of the 13 in the mid-1960s, mid-1980s, and mid-1990s. And you know, you can bash your head against the wall about trying to get the exact timing, but Fed tightening cycles tend to lead to recession, just as Fed easing cycles tend to lead to recovery. So the mid-60s, mid-80s, and mid-90s were special because actually those were early cycle, not 10 years into it. We had lots of slack in the economy left during those periods. And the Fed actually cut the funds rate on average 175 basis points. You know, the Fed hasn't done anything. They've only jawboned the market, switched their bias. But the last time I remember, the Fed actually tightened policy into a maelstrom in December the 19th, and they haven't taken that back yet. So I think we're putting a little too much credence on the Fed because of the rhetoric. The bottom line is that they haven't started easing yet. And everything that they've done this cycle, which is over 300 basis points of tightening with rates and with the balance sheet, the lagged impacts are going to hit home this year, as they've done in other cycles. The lags are 12 to 18 months.
The problem,
and I think that's going to define.
Some would argue with the fact, and no one's saying that Fed tightening cycles don't produce recession eventually, but we also have a multi-trillion dollar Fed balance sheet right now, which sort of acts as a cushion, not to mention what's going on in the rest of the world. And yes, that trend is reversing, and perhaps that's creating some volatility, but it definitely has helped elongate this expansion. You've also got this shot in the arm of fiscal stimulus that we got toward the end of the recovery. I mean, all of this is why some say we still have longer to go when it comes to the expansion.
Well, the fiscal stimulus, most of that is behind us, not ahead of us. And as far as the Fed's balance sheet is concerned, I mean, it's not levels that matter, because we're talking about growth. So it's not about levels. The change in the Fed's balance sheet is down, not up. The change in interest rates is up, not down. So it's really the rates of change, because in the markets, what matters most is at the margin. Now, look, I was having these same debates internally, and I probably was on the same show back in late 2007 having a very similar conversation. Or, for example, back in late 2000, the lags between what the Fed does in time A and the impact it has in times, you know, STUV, those are 12 to 18 months. Those lags hit home this year in the most leveraged economy in modern history. And in terms of following where the bubble is this time, it's not about the banks, and it's not about households or mortgages. It's clearly on the corporate balance sheet. So when I'm taking a look at what's going to define this year, and by the way, you're seeing it in all the data, the core capital goods orders unmistakably are in a downturn. You can talk about how much fiscal stimulus there is. That fiscal stimulus was broadly aimed at stimulating a capital spending cycle. We had two quarters of it, and it's over. And the survey data are pointing in the same direction. This is the year of the corporate sector debt diet. It's corporate deleveraging. It's going to have an impact on GDP, knock-on impacts in other sectors. And I know it might not be apparent to the naked eye right now, because we're getting really caught in this bear market rally, which is rather breathtaking. But I think that we'll be talking about something totally different 3 to 6 months from now. Because ultimately the economy does matter, and the reality is that a lot of people I speak to give me a lot of pushback on this view. But the question I would pose back at them is, why is it that core capital goods orders are down 3 of the past 4 months and rolling over? Why are companies telling you they're cutting back on their spending plans this year? That's the only reason why
we're not seeing
companies being downgraded, is because they're strengthening their balance sheets, which ultimately is good, but it's going to come at the expense of capital spending and aggregate demand. And that's the story for this year.